God, who is rich in mercy, because of the great with him, and has seated us with him in the heavens. For by grace, faith, and this is not from you, it is God has prepared in advance, and he shall live in them.
Spirit,
a reading from
pray to you, O Lord.
As Moses in the desert, said to Nicodemus, as Moses did not in the desert, so that everyone who believes in him may have the world on the sun, so that does not believe has already been cut. Does not believe. Darkness to fear evil. Those who can is his life. might be exposed. But whatever comes to the light, so that
Holy Spirit, come and fill us, fall afresh upon us to receive the Word of God. Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name we pray. As we gather here this morning, I do want to give a special greeting to Finbar and Michael and Isabella and Eric, as we remember Priscilla on this day. Actually, her anniversary of passing is just, I think, Tuesday, perhaps. And we thank God for her life, and we ask that the Lord might grant her eternal life, and that we might one day share in that joy with her, and that in the meantime that we might share in the fellowship with her, the communion of the saints. In Jesus' name, amen. Today is the midway of Lent. It's called Laetare Sunday, and it's rejoicing. And some may think it's rejoicing because I made it halfway through Lent. And that may be partially true, but it is much more than that. It's much deeper than that. The rejoicing comes in the midst of the darkness, in the midst of the loss, in the midst of the messiness of this life. And the rejoicing comes because of that gospel reading, what it declares to us, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever might believe in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. And that God didn't send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that we may have life in his name. And John 10:10 says, I came that you may have life. Jesus says, I came that you may have life and have it abundantly. And so we receive that word in faith, and we ask the Lord, show us what that looks like. Teach us, Lord, please. And so let us look at the gospel reading together to understand a little bit about how this might, how this word might come to us and be food and nourishment, consolation and strength for our lives. Jesus says in the gospel, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. That's a strange kind of statement that Jesus made. Now we know he was lifted up on the cross, so we understand that in this way, but it's good for us to know this scripture in light of the Old Testament, the Hebrew scriptures, so that we may understand it correctly. He is referring to Numbers 21. And there, the Israelites were in the desert. And they were, as they were accustomed to doing, they were doing their teenage thing. They were grumbling. These manna burgers, these manna waffles, these manna bagels, these manna everything. They didn't want manna anymore. They wanted the stuff that they had in Egypt, the food, comforts. It wasn't really comforts, they were slaves. But they didn't yet see what God was doing. But God was providing for them in the middle of the wilderness, in the middle of the desert wilderness. And he was doing this through the manna and also through the quail that he would send, the birds, that they would have food, meat. And yet, they complained against the Lord. And it says that in the scriptures that God sent seraph serpents. That's in Numbers, not the reading we read, but in Numbers 21. God sent seraph serpents to bite them. He sent serpents to bite them, snakes to bite them, and many were dying as a result of that. And they cried out to God, as the Israelites would often do after they realized, what was I thinking? This is my food. I can't lose this. I can't, even though I'm not content with this, I realize I'm not dying. I need to grow up. I need to realize that this is God's provision. And God has a purpose for this. And I need to trust him. But they had a hard time doing that. They had a constant tendency to grumble against the Lord. And if you think of this situation in the desert, they were complaining that the food was not to their liking. And then snakes came and bit them as a result of their grumbling. And they were dying. If you think for a moment, there was another story in the Bible that goes back to the book of Genesis. And it's where a serpent came to our first parents. And they weren't verbally grumbling about the food that was given. But God said, you can eat anything here, anything. Just don't eat that. It's poison. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil is the way it was described. And the serpent came and he bit them. How did he bite them? He bit them with the temptation to not trust God. To not trust God. And they gave in to that. And as a result, sin brought death. That sickness and death, suffering. And that was not God's original plan. Death wasn't God's original plan. God's plan was life. But death came into the world through sin. But that's not the end of the story, because the Lord had already provided the remedy. It says in the first reading, there was no remedy. Yes, there was no natural remedy for this sickness of sin and death. There is no natural remedy for the reality of death. There's no natural taking away from that great loss that death would bring. But there is a another kind of remedy that God had in mind, that he had in store. And that remedy is described when Jesus says, just as Moses lifted up the serpent, the Saraph serpent, the bronze serpent. Saraph is, it's a word that signifies fire. That's one of the translations of this text. Symbolizes fire. And it's a term that's also used in reference to angels. Seraphim. It's one of the choirs of angels. And this is a reality that the seraph serpents are comparable to and representing the reality of the fallen angels, the devil, who had enticed Adam and Eve, who would entice all of humanity to folly, to not trust God. And so this sickness of the sickness of sin infected all of humanity. Sometimes the church has given us a description of this in the term original sin. We inherited from Adam and Eve, which is taken away in baptism, thanks be to God, but still the residue of this is the concupiscence. We still deal with that tendency towards folly. Now, looking at the gospel, I'm going to go back to that remedy that Jesus speaks of. He says, just like Moses lifted up the Saraph serpent in the desert, the bronze serpent, and all who looked upon it, that's what happened in Numbers 21, all who looked upon that Saraph serpent, even though they were bitten by the snakes, would be healed and would not die. And that's actually a foreshadowing, a sneak preview, you might say, of what would be given to us in Jesus. As Jesus says, just like that Saraph serpent was lifted up and people were healed, even more so, when the Son of Man is lifted up on the cross and also lifted up in his resurrection, when he is lifted up. And those who believe in him, remember the gospel says that whosoever believe in him might not perish, but have everlasting life, eternal life. That those who see him, look up at him, not just the crucifix, but look up at him with faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, who was crucified and risen, that death would no longer be the final word for them. Because in Jesus, death has been defeated. Death has been conquered by the Lord Jesus Christ. We who are believers, it says in the scriptures that we mourn, but not like the rest who have no hope. For we have hope because we know that Jesus Christ, who was lifted up, has conquered death and has defeated the power of death and has literally crushed the head of the serpent. What does that mean, that he's crushed his head? It means that he has been mortally wounded. That is, the one who brought death has been mortally wounded by the obedience of Jesus and by his suffering, his death, his resurrection. And it is true that God could have saved us anyway. He could have saved us simply by declaration. He could say, I forgive your sins and be healed. He certainly did that with various people, the paralytic that the people lowered down through the roof. And the Lord said to him, your sins are forgiven. Of course, the Pharisees and scribes are freaking out. And he said, well, if I let me show you that I have authority to forgive sins, be healed, stand up and walk. And he stood up and he walked. And he was healed. And the Lord, who was raised up, has the power to forgive sins, but the will And as I said, he could have done it any way he wanted with a declaration. But the Lord Jesus Christ didn't want to just pardon us, but he wanted to pay the price for that pardon. He wanted to pay the price. He wanted us to see the costliness of that price that he has paid for us. He wanted us to see it. And I don't know if you've ever had this experience, but I have been blessed to have see someone who loves me suffer for me, for my good. It's a painful thing to see when you open your heart to that. Parents do that all the time for their children. I am sure that Priscilla did that lots for you guys. And mothers do that in a particular way, as Priscilla did. And Jesus Christ is the ultimate example of that. That he suffered. He didn't just pardon us, but he paid the price for that pardon on the cross, enduring all the humiliation, all the agony, all the torture, the rejection, the weight of our sins. He took all of that upon himself. And the young people are going to watch the Passion of the Christ movie today after Mass. And that's a tough movie to watch. I think all Christians should watch it. You don't have to look at every detail. I certainly, when I watched it, I closed my eyes on the scourging part. It was too brutal. I just couldn't handle it. It was just too much. And all I did was finger my rosary through the whole, that was the best rosary I ever prayed. That was more than one rosary, actually. The best rosary I ever prayed of the sorrowful mysteries again and again as I watched it and went through those beads with Our Lady. In fact, that's the only way we stay at the foot of the cross is with our Blessed Mother. We don't have the courage. We won't have the courage to stay on the foot. We'll do every like, just like all the other apostles, we'll either betray him or deny him or just run from him at the time of suffering. But when we stay with Mary, the sorrowful mother, we have a courage beyond human courage. There's a grace beyond nature to be where we ought to be, to where we need to be, to where we must be for God's purpose to be accomplished in our lives. That's through the power of Mother Mary's intercession. That's why John the Apostle was able to be there, because he stayed with Mary. And Mary wasn't going to leave her son. But we are blessed to be able to, in this season of Lent, to look upon the suffering of Jesus, to look upon the one who was pierced for love of us, that we might have our hearts pierced by our hardness, by our unforgiveness, by the absurdity of our unforgiveness, our resentments, our pride, absurdity of pride, and all the sins that we justify, that when we see Jesus crucified, pierced in the agony, and we realize he did that for me, we have an opportunity to allow our hearts to be converted, our hard hearts to be pierced, broken, so that they might be open to grace. And this is why Jesus didn't just pardon us. He wanted to show us the sacrificial nature of love, especially his love for us. And it wasn't just so that we would watch it like we'd watch a movie. What a terrible thing to see the Passion of Christ and just watch it as a movie. Wow. Oh my goodness. You don't get it. No, it's not meant to be a movie. It's meant to break my heart. It's meant to convert me. It's meant to melt my hard heart. You know why? Does God just want me to be miserable? Is that why? Is that why we watch the Passion of the Christ, why we pray the Stations of the Cross, why we meditate upon the sorrowful mysteries? Is that why? Or is it really that we might be converted so that we might love him in return? That we might love him. Give him a little token of the love that he gives to us. You see, that's God's reason. That's why he went through all that passion. Because he's trying to teach us what love is. He didn't just tell us, this is what you have to do. He says, I'm going to show you what love is. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever would believe in him, just believe in him, is that it? All the weight of my sins washed away just because I believe in him? Brothers and sisters, even though as Catholics we recognize that has to be manifest in good works, of course, but the fundamental nature of salvation is through faith. It is. It's through faith. Through faith, we cannot please God without faith. Cannot. You do all the works in the world, but if you don't have faith in him, he's like, doesn't mean anything. I don't receive it. Of course, faith, there's a little detail there, faith and repentance, they kind of go together. Because what happens is, and what God wants to do, is he wants us first to see the significance of the realities of what's going on. That there are two kingdoms. Now, there's the kingdom of God, and there's the kingdom of the world, the kingdom that is under the enemy, the devil. Now, there's no comparison in those two kingdoms. It's not like God is saying, oh, no, what am I going to do? Absolutely not. It's not real. No, God, with a little, he's like an elephant and a mouse. You could just step on it without any problem. But he wants us to participate in this victory. He wants us to put some skin in the game. He wants us to participate in this work of love so that love may convert us so that we might become love. Because God is love. And we are created in the image and likeness of God. We are created for love. Thank God for the beautiful example of Priscilla. Thank God for that beautiful example. You're blessed. And thank God for the different examples, perhaps, in our lives that we've had. But the reality and the fullness is Jesus himself. And Jesus himself is the one that inspired her. And he wants to inspire us. And of course, you think, what do you think Priscilla's praying for? What do you think she's praying for? As we pray for her, you will never hear out of this mouth unless the church has already declared it that she's in heaven. I'm not anxious about her. I know the one she trusted in is totally worthy of that trust. Period. Exclamation point. But I also recognize that on the day that I'm not here and I'm in a casket and someone else is preaching here, he better not say Father Joseph's in heaven. I'll reach up and smack him. Because I'll need those prayers. Don't deprive me of that. So our love for Priscilla is to be able to say, yes, I'm still praying for you. And I'm counting on your prayers, Priscilla. You know? And that's the reality. That's beautiful communion of the saints. It's the most wonderful gift. In the midst of great, incredible loss of death, God gives this sweetness that only God can give. Because, like, you don't have to pick up the phone. She's not suffering. She's not dealing with any of the stuff we're dealing with. She is free to give her heart to God. And even though, Finbar, you're...
Thank you. Thank you. give thanks to the Lord. And our participating in the mystery. May be led to the fullness of bring life to all things, and you make them holy. You never see, so that from the sun to its setting, O Lord, we Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that himself to bread, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples. For this is my God. When supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Savior, forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy sacrifice. Lord, we pray upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim. Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May you make the walls of the tender offering to the Holy Spirit. His blessed is the heart's heart. The blessed apostles and glorious martyrs and all the saints of whose constant intercession in your presence rely upon.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Savior's command by divine teaching.
God in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Gracious in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Behold and see with the eyes of faith Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall. here at St. Antoninus, you are welcome to receive either standing or kneeling. You're also welcome to receive either on your hand or on your tongue. We distribute Holy Communion to those who receive on their tongue. We're able to give a communion under both species through a tincture. We'll have three stations, and so I need three Eucharistic ministers, two sisters, and a Eucharistic minister. And you would just, if you're receiving on your tongue, obviously put your tongue out. If you're receiving on your hand, raise your hand.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The children, I know I'm a educator, do not take one person as impossible. This is just something I'm using to illustrate collaboration, okay? One person is still two. All right. So please, everyone, mark this day for us. October 6th, we will be calling on you. I know Priscilla was an advocate of making the church to be built, especially the facilities of the church. So that was something that I never considered. We won't call you to, if you like, the bathroom inside there, which is really always wrong.
To reach Satan.